If you've paid any attention to climate news over the past decade, you've probably heard the number 1.5 tossed around a lot.
1.5 to stay alive! 1.5 to stay alive!
So why are we talking about it so much? 1.5 degrees Celsius comes from the Paris Agreement. Back in 2015, countries of the world came together to try to lower greenhouse gas emissions. The goal? Limit global warming to well below 2 degrees Celsius above pre-industrial levels and pursue efforts to limit it to 1.5 degrees Celsius. Not that we're doomed if we go over 1.5 degrees Celsius, but scientists agree that if we can stay under that, we can significantly reduce risks, impacts, losses, and damages caused by climate change. And maybe even avert crossing climate tipping points beyond which the world can't recover. So it's a pretty important goal, but there's a problem.
The truth is, almost 10 years since the Paris Agreement was adopted, the target of limiting long-term global warming to 1.5 degrees Celsius is hanging by a thread. We already face incursions into 1.5 degree territory. There is an 8% chance the global annual average temperature will exceed the 1.5 degree limit in at least one of the next 5 years.
If you think that's bad, brace yourself for these headlines. World breaches key 1.5 degrees Celsius warming mark for record number of days. June 2024 marks 12th month of global temperatures at 1.5 degrees Celsius above pre-industrial levels. It's not good news, that's for sure. But here's the thing, there's a big difference between temporarily crossing the 1.5 degrees Celsius for days or weeks or months or a year versus long-term warming as defined by the Paris Agreement. So, have we crossed 1.5 degrees Celsius yet? No. But spoiler alert, we may cross that long-term limit sometime in the next decade. More on that in a minute. First, let's explore what the world might look like if we breach that 1.5 degrees Celsius. And to see what it's like, look no further than 2023.
No way, bro!
Record-breaking floods, historic wildfires and smoke, deadly hurricanes that rapidly intensified, and above all, heat.
The era of global warming has ended. The era of global boiling has arrived.
That guy's really got away with words. But the fact is, 2023 was the Earth's hottest year on record, by a mile. Global temperatures were 1.45 degrees Celsius, or 2.6 degrees Fahrenheit above pre-industrial levels. That's according to the World Meteorological Organization. The gobsmackingly bananas heat was fueled, in part, by a strong El Nino event. Here's climate scientist Zeke Hausfather.
Global temperatures have been exceptionally elevated over the last year. It's also coincided with a fairly sizable El Nino event, which can add up to 0.2 of a degree C to global temperatures. And so a big El Nino is just a little peek forward to what temperatures are going to be like a decade from now.
Well, that's concerning. But 2023 was a head-scratcher for climate scientists like Zeke, even with the boost from El Nino.
Many of us at the start of 2023 were arguing that 2024 would be the really warm year because historically it's the year after the El Nino event peaks, like 1998 or 2016, that is the really exceptionally record-setting year in terms of global temperatures. In many ways, what was weird is that 2023 was so warm, and there's some worry in the community that, you know, maybe there are other factors contributing to recent warmth.
Factors like the Hunga Tonga volcanic eruption, a reduction in shipping pollution that could have actually affected cloud formation, and
there are concerns that, you know, there might be evidence of an acceleration in warming.
2024 is picking right up where 2023 left off, with ever-increasing odds that it will beat 2023 as the new hottest year on record. And as we mentioned earlier, the WMO says there's now an 80% likelihood that average global temperatures will temporarily exceed 1.5 degrees Celsius for at least one of the next 5 years. Back in 2015, the chances of that were close to zero. But that still doesn't mean that the Paris Agreement target of 1.5 degrees Celsius is dead.
It's not yet dead, but it's hanging by a thread.
The Paris Agreement target refers to long-term temperature increases over decades, not over a month, not over a year, or even over 5 years. Temporary breaches do not mean that the 1.5 goal is permanently lost. But the trend is alarming and cannot be denied.
Think of it like jumping on an escalator. You go up a little bit, you spike down, but overall, you're going up. So when, you may be wondering, will we actually breach the 1.5 degrees Celsius? Well, it kind of depends who you ask.
The Paris Agreement itself was a little vague about how these temperature targets are defined, but the Intergovernmental Panel on Climate Change has generally defined when we pass 1.5 degrees or 2 degrees as the middle of a 20-year period where the average temperatures are at that level. The problem with that definition, of course, is that we won't actually know when the world passed 1.5 degrees until 10 years after we actually do.
But who wants to wait 10 years to find out? Hugh, the eager scientist, trying to find a workaround. Warning, this part gets a little nerdy.
There's been a couple of different approaches proposed. Richard Betts at the UK Met Office and colleagues suggested using historical data for the last 10 years and sort of climate model projections for the next 10 years, and still using the 20-year average to define when we pass these targets, but, you know, combining historical observations with models. There's other approaches that use climate models to tease out the human contribution to warming to date.
But beware, hot models, no, not those. The kind of models that have high climate sensitivity and predict future warming that scientists say gets too hot, too fast. Sorry, continue, Zeke.
And there's statistical approaches as well to try to sort of isolate the long-term signal from the noise in the observations. And in all of these different estimates, you end up passing 1.5 degrees, you know, in terms of long-term temperatures, somewhere in the late 2020s or early 2030s, at least in scenarios where we don't very, very rapidly reduce emissions.
And since that doesn't seem to be happening anytime soon, it kind of feels like we're living in a world that will fall short of the Paris goals. But climate scientists like Zeke still have hope.
We need to recognize that 1.5 degrees is a target and not a threshold. You know, it's not like everything is fine at 1.4 degrees, and then as soon as we pass 1.5 degrees, catastrophe happens, right? The same sort of impacts we're talking about, heat waves, storms, wildfire, extreme precipitation, sea level rise, these all get progressively worse with more warming. Or as we climate scientists like to say these days, every tenth of a degree matters. And so just because we seem to be on track at this point to pass 1.5 degrees in the next decade doesn't mean we need to stop our efforts to limit warming to 1.6 or 1.7. You know, there still is a lot of room to meet the broader Paris Agreement goals of limiting warming to well below 2 degrees.
This means that the faster we act, the better things we'll get for planet Earth. And the good news is, the solutions we need are already right here.
Many of the solutions to climate change are becoming much cheaper. You know, today, the cheapest form of new energy in most of the world is solar power. And that wasn't true 5 years ago. Carbon removal is sort of a weird case because it doesn't have value outside of mitigating climate change. But a lot of the other technologies we're talking about, clean energy, electric vehicles, are really appealing independent of their climate benefits. They're cheaper than fossil fuel alternatives. And I think the more we can develop technologies that fit that profile, that are just good ideas to do, even if your goal is not just to solve climate change, the more rapidly we are gonna solve this problem.